In this video, we will be talking about the binary eutectic phase diagrams. So there are two things that we need to clarify first. First is the term binary and the term eutectic. So the term binary symbolizes that in the system, the number of component is 2. The second term eutectic defines the eutectic temperature, that is the temperature below which everything in the system is in the solid phase. For this video, we will be looking at the eutectic system of diapside and anorthite. That has two components. One is the diapside component, the other is the anorthite component. Now let us compare this diagram with the solid solution phase diagram of the anorthite albite system. In both of these diagrams, the green line represents the solidus and the red line represents the liquidus. So we can see at the higher temperature in both the fields, the liquid phase is stable. In the eutectic system, we see there are two fields in which a liquid and a solid can coexist together. While in the solid solution series, you see that there is only one field in which the solid and the liquid can coexist. Now in the eutectic system, you see below the solidus, the system has two phases stable. One is of diapside and one is of anorthite. And hence, below the solidus in the eutectic system, it is a two-phase field. While if you look in the solid solution series, you will find below the solidus only one phase is stable, that is of a solid solution between albite and anorthite. This is because in the albite anorthite system, complete solid solution can occur, and hence at lower temperatures they both intermix and form one phase, while in the diapside anorthite system no solid solution can occur, and hence below the solidus they form separate diapside and anorthite phases. Now let us apply the phase rule on this system. Let us start with the liquidus field. So phase rule is given by P plus F is equal to C plus 2. In the liquid field, only one phase is stable, that is of the liquid phase. The degree of freedom we have to calculate. The number of component is 2, one is anorthite, the other is diapside. So that gives us 2 plus 2 is 4. So degree of freedom comes out to be 3. Now we see for such diagrams, the pressure is constant, and hence we have graphically reduced the degree of freedom by 1, and what we are left with is a degree of freedom of 2. And hence this liquid field is a divariant field. If we look at this anorthite plus liquid field, so phase rule is given by P plus F is C plus 2. Number of phases is 2, one is of anorthite, the other is of liquid. Degree of freedom we have to calculate. Number of component is still 2, one of anorthite, the other of diapside. So degree of freedom is 2. And we have graphically reduced the degree of freedom by 1 by keeping pressure constant. And we are left with a degree of freedom 1. And hence these fields are univariant. Now what does this term univariant mean? It means that if we have a system in which liquid plus anorthite is stable, then that means we are talking about this field right here. And if I mention the temperature at which we are looking at the system, let us say T1, then from that temperature value, you can find out what is the liquid composition and what is the solid composition. The liquid composition can be read out from the x-axis, let us say it is XA, and the solid composition is of pure anorthite. Thus, if you know the temperature of the system, you know the composition of both the liquid and the solid. And hence, if you know at what temperature the system is, you can find out the liquid composition as well as the solid composition of the system. And vice versa, if you know the chemical composition of the liquid phase and the solid phase, then you can know the temperature of the system, that is T1. In short, you need to quantify only one variable, that is the temperature or the composition, and hence these fields are known as univariant. Now let us look why the liquid field is known as divariant. If I tell you we are in the field of only one liquid phase stable, then I am talking about this field right here, and I say we are looking at temperature T1. At T1, a liquid of this composition is also stable. A liquid of this composition is also stable. A liquid of this composition is also stable. And hence, I need to mention what temperature are we talking about, as well as the composition of the liquid phase we are talking about. And hence, I need to mention two variables. One is the temperature, the other is the composition, and thus these fields are known as divariant. If we look in the diapside plus anorthite field, then phase rule is P plus F is C plus 2. The number of phases is 2, one is the anorthite phase, the other is the diapside phase. Number of component is still 2, 1 anorthite, 1 diapside, and hence degree of freedom is 2. Graphically, it is reduced by 1 by keeping pressure constant, and the degree of freedom we are left with is 1. And thus these fields are also univariant. Now let us look at the eutectic point of the system. This point right here, at which the liquidus and the solidus line intersect, is known as the eutectic point. And this temperature is known as the eutectic temperature. At the eutectic point, you can see all these four fields are stable, and hence at the eutectic, the liquid phase, the anorthite phase, and the diapside phase, all three are stable. So if we apply the phase rule, we will find out number of phases is 3, the degree of freedom we need to calculate, number of component is still 2, and hence degree of freedom is 1. Graphically, it is reduced by 1 and we are left with a degree of freedom of 0, and hence this point is invariant. What invariance means is that if I tell you we are at the eutectic system, and hence my system consists of liquid plus diapside plus anorthite, then I don't need to mention the temperature and the bulk composition of the system. It is already fixed. At the eutectic, you can have only one temperature possible, that is TE, temperature of eutectic. Also, the bulk composition of the system is fixed at XE. And hence, if I tell you that we are at the eutectic point, then you already know at what temperature we are and at what bulk composition we are, and hence no other variable is required, and thus this point is an invariant point. Now we will learn how to read these phase diagrams, and we will start with the case of equilibrium crystallization. Equilibrium means that the system is closed and hence no transfer of mass can occur, and crystallization means that we are starting with a liquid phase and ending in a solid phase of the same composition. Let us say the bulk composition of the system is given by XA, and we are starting in the liquid field at temperature T1. So we see that in the system there is only a single phase of liquid of composition XA at temperature T1. Now we cool the system till it intersects the liquidus, let us say at temperature T2, and we create an isotherm, that is the line perpendicular to the T-axis, to see at what bulk composition it intersects the liquidus and the phase diagram. So we see it intersects the liquidus at composition XA, and the other point of intersection is this point. This point represents the composition of the solid phase, and we can read from the phase diagram that this is of pure anorthite, and hence at temperature T2 we find out that we have a system in which liquid of XA composition is stable. Alongside it, very minute amount of solid is stable of bulk composition pure anorthite. We cool the system further, let us say to temperature T3, we create an isotherm. We find that it intersects the liquidus at this point, and the other point of intersection is this. We can read from the x-axis that the bulk composition of the liquid is, let us say, XB, and that of solid is pure anorthite, and hence at temperature T3, we have a liquid of bulk composition XB and a solid of composition anorthite stable. Now one thing to notice is that from temperature T2 to T3, the amount of solid has increased, while from T2 to T3, the amount of liquid in the system has decreased. The exact proportion of solid and liquid at temperature T3 can be read from the phase diagram using the lever principle. Now the bulk composition of the system is XA, so we plot XA on the isotherm, and let us say this line is of A length and this line is of B length. And by the lever rule, the proportion of liquid by solid in the system is given by B by A. Now the system is further cooled till it reaches the eutectic temperature, at which both diapside and anorthite crystallize. At the eutectic, this reaction occurs, liquid changes to both diapside and anorthite. Let us say the bulk composition at the eutectic is given by Xe. Then at temperature TE, you have in the system a liquid of composition Xe. And now two solid phases are stable. One is of diapside, one is of anorthite. And the exact proportion in which diapside and anorthite crystallize from this liquid of Xe bulk composition can be read out from the phase diagram. If this line segment is of length A and this line segment is of length B, then the proportion of anorthite by diapside that crystallizes at the eutectic is given by A by B. Now after all the liquid has crystallized into diapside plus anorthite at the eutectic and the liquid is lost, then the temperature can cool down further. And let us look at the system at temperature T4. So at temperature T4, we find out that there are two solids stable. One is of anorthite composition and the other is of diapside composition. Now the exact proportion in which anorthite and diapside are stable in the system can be read from the phase diagram by creating an isotherm from T4. If this line segment is of unit A length and this line segment is of length B, then the proportion of anorthite versus diapside in the system is given by B by A. And hence we see that you start with a liquid of XA composition and end up with anorthite plus diapside in the system, and the relative proportion of these can be read from this equation, the average of which would still be XA because it is a closed system and hence no chemical entity can be lost. Now let us look at the case of equilibrium melting. Now let the bulk composition of the system be given by XA as in the last example, and we are starting at a temperature T4. So we know that in the system both anorthite and diapside are stable. As you heat the system, it would reach the eutectic temperature TE and the reaction diapside plus anorthite changes to liquid will proceed. Thus at temperature TE, you will find that both anorthite and diapside are stable with a liquid of bulk composition XE stable with them. Now this reaction will undergo till one of the reactant, that is diapside or anorthite, is exhausted. And in our system, we see that the bulk composition XA plots closer to anorthite, and hence we have more of anorthite in the system, and we will see that diapside is exhausted first, and thus we are left in the system with a liquid of composition XE and a solid of pure anorthite composition. Now as you increase the temperature, the liquid will follow the liquidus curve, and let us say we are looking at the system at temperature T3. So from the phase diagram, we create an isotherm at temperature T3, it intersects the liquidus at this point and the solid composition is given by this point, and we see we have a system in which a liquid of bulk composition XB is stable with a solid of anorthite composition stable. The exact proportion of these two liquid and solid phases can be read from the phase diagram using the lever rule. We further increase the temperature and we reach temperature T2, and we find out that a liquid of composition XA is stable in the system with very fine amount of anorthite stable in the system. And as the system is heated further, all the anorthite is lost and only one phase liquid of bulk composition XA is stable in the system. The steps that you saw in equilibrium melting were exactly the opposite of the steps that were seen in the case of equilibrium crystallization. The one thing to notice in the case of equilibrium crystallization or melting is that in case of equilibrium crystallization, the last melt that is stable is of the eutectic composition at the eutectic temperature, and in the case of equilibrium melting, the first melt that is generated is of the eutectic composition at the eutectic temperature. This is the most important thing to remember for these phase diagrams. Now let us look at the case of fractional melting. Fractional melting means that you melt a solid to generate a liquid, and then the liquid is removed from the system, and what you are left in the system is just the solid phase. The liquid phase is lost. So let us start with a bulk composition XA of the system, and we are looking at temperature T4, and hence it plots at this point, and thus in the system we have diapside and anorthite stable. The system is heated and we reach the temperature of eutectic TE, and we find out that a liquid of composition XE is stable in the system along with anorthite and diapside. At the eutectic, we see anorthite and diapside both react to create the eutectic liquid of bulk composition XE. Now we know in our system we have more of anorthite than of diapside, and hence in this reaction diapside will exhaust first and we will be left with only anorthite in the solid phase. And hence we will see that we have a liquid stable in the system of composition XE, and no diapside is stable in the system, only anorthite is present. Now if fractionation happens and the liquid is removed from the system, what we are left with in the system is pure anorthite. What this means is that we started with a bulk composition XA, but now the bulk composition of the system is this, of pure anorthite. Now your system is pure anorthite, and this is very significant. What this means is that if you want to melt your system, you would have to reach the melting point of pure anorthite. What this means is that you were at the temperature of eutectic and you generated a liquid of composition XE, the eutectic composition. Now to generate melt, you need to increase the temperature of the system to the melting point of pure anorthite to generate a melt of composition of pure anorthite. Between these temperatures, the TE and the T pure anorthite, no melting can occur. And hence you have seen in the case of equilibrium melting, the temperature gradually melts at different temperatures. But in the fractional melting case, you see that the first melt that is generated is at temperature TE, and if you remove that melt from the system and you are left with pure anorthite, then you can only melt the system at temperature TAN. In between these two temperatures, no melting can occur. Now let us look at the case of fractional crystallization. In fractional crystallization, a liquid changes into solid and the solid that is generated is removed from the system, and what you are left in the system is the liquid phase only. Let us say you are at temperature T2 and you have a liquid of XA composition and you have pure anorthite stable. Now because of fractionation, this anorthite is lost from the system. Now at temperature T3, you find yourself with a liquid of composition XB and a pure anorthite solid. Now if fractionation occurs, the anorthite solid is lost from the system and you are left with the liquid XB only. At temperature of the eutectic, you find out that you have a liquid of composition XE and you have both anorthite and diapside stable in the system. Now at the eutectic, this reaction is occurring, liquid is changing into anorthite and diapside, and when all of the liquid crystallizes, you are just left with the anorthite and diapside in the system. Now you see the fractional crystallization case is similar to the equilibrium crystallization case. The only difference is that in the equilibrium crystallization state, you started with a bulk composition XA of liquid, and in the final solid, you still find the average bulk of the system to be XA. But in the fractional crystallization case, you saw that the anorthite crystals that were generated at different temperatures were lost from the system. And finally, when the system crystallized at the temperature of eutectic, the final bulk composition of the system was that of the composition of the eutectic. What this means is that you started with a bulk composition XA of the liquid and you end up having solids of bulk composition XE. Now you can see that XA is more anorthite rich than Xe. Now why the final bulk composition of your system has less anorthite than what you started with is because a lot of anorthite was fractionated from the system, and hence your system gradually changed into a more diabside rich system. Now let us look at the different textures that are formed in the anorthite diabside system. The first one we will study is the ophitic texture. In the ophitic texture, you find out that you have small laths of plagioclase that are included in big grains of pyroxene. The most common misinterpretation of this texture is that plagioclase is considered to be older than the diabside grain. We can easily disprove the hypothesis why plagioclase is older than diabside using this graphical representation. Let us consider plagioclase has a very high nucleation rate while diabside has a low nucleation rate. What this means is that a lot of plagioclase crystals are growing, and at the same time, very few diabside crystals are growing. Now we will have a close look on this diabside crystal and this anorthite crystal. Now these two are growing simultaneously, and we see that at one point the diabside grain captures the plagioclase grain, and if they are allowed to grow more, we will find that the diabside grain captures the plagioclase grain as an inclusion, but they were growing simultaneously together. This is because plagioclase has a high nucleation rate, but the growth rate of plagioclase is smaller, while the diabside has a low nucleation rate, but the growth rate is greater than of plagioclase. And hence diabside grows faster than plagioclase, and eventually it takes up crystals of plagioclase as inclusions. And hence we have proved the ophitic texture can form by simultaneous growth of diabside and plagioclase. One should keep in mind that ophitic texture can also form if the plagioclase crystal is older than the diabside crystal. So both of these causes can be the reason for growth of ophitic texture. Now we have talked a lot about the simultaneous growth of diabside and plagioclase, and we have already seen this occurs at the eutectic of such systems, and hence at the eutectic both of these crystallize simultaneously, and hence they can lead to the formation of ophitic texture. The second texture is sub-ophitic. In the sub-ophitic texture, what one sees is that the plagioclase laths are not completely included in the pyroxene grains. This is because the nucleation rate of pyroxene crystals is slightly higher than the nucleation rate in the ophitic texture case. What this means is that a lot of nucleation sites for the pyroxene crystals are also generated. This causes the growth rate to decrease in comparison to the ophitic texture growth rate, and we see an incomplete enclosure of plagioclase in the pyroxene crystals. If you like the content that I create, then do subscribe and help me in creating more content like this.